Tonight's program is the sixth Joan H. Tisch Public Health Forum, an annual public program that brings together leading figures for discussion about the most important public health challenges facing our country. The forum is one component of the Joan Tisch Legacy Project, made possible by the generosity of the Tisch family. It is a testament to the impact of the Tisch Legacy Project that so many members of our Hunter community signed up for tonight's event, so many that we had to move it from Roosevelt House to the K Playhouse in order to accommodate all the interest. Today's generation of young people understands that food policy is an urgent matter that needs immediate attention, and we know that our Hunter students will be at the forefront of action. I'm sure the provocative movie you just watched and the conversation you're about to hear will motivate many of you to help identify creative solutions to the obesity epidemic and its devastating consequences. Thanks to the Joan Tisch Legacy Project, Hunter College and Roosevelt House have become major centers of health policy research, discussion, and debate. None of this would have been possible without the extraordinary generosity of Laurie Tisch and her brothers, Steve and John, who chose to honor their mother by intensifying and focusing the public health conversation. Joan Tisch was a great and dynamic advocate for public health awareness. Her influence was particularly felt in the area of advocacy for people with AIDS, an area in which she was an early crusader. The Joan H. Tisch Legacy Project could have no more fitting home than Roosevelt House, the former residence of another iconic New York family dedicated to public service, the Roosevelts. Like Joan Tisch, Eleanor Roosevelt did more than talk about improving the lives of her fellow citizens. She was a hands-on activist. Eleanor took streetcars and walked through the Bowery slums to get to the Lower East Side Settlement House, where she taught calisthenics and dance. And also like Joan Tisch, she helped raise awareness of the lives of the less fortunate and instilled in her family a sense of civic responsibility. No wonder that both families became icons of public service and venerable agents of social reform. We at Hunter continue to be inspired by the Tisches, and particularly by Laurie Tisch's long-standing commitment to improving food policy in particular, and her novel yet practical approaches to doing something about food disparity, obesity, and other health-related food issues. In particular, her Green Cart program, which promotes healthy eating in low-income neighborhoods, has been such a success that has been replicated in urban areas around the country. The Children Museum's anti-obesity curriculum, an exhibit for young children, which she supported, has recently had exhibits at Hunter College and in housing projects in other places around the country. With Laurie's help, the food center is also now contributing to the creation of effective food policy and helping to reduce food disparity and other social, environmental, and health-related food problems. In all of these partnerships, Laurie's contributions have transformed debate and policy about food and health in New York City and beyond. Her mother, Joan, could not have asked for a better upholder of her legacy. And her greatest gift of all is the inspiration she provided to you, our students, to put public service and active citizenship front and center in your lives. Laurie was planned to be with us tonight, and we are so sorry that she is under the weather and will not be able to join us. But I want to ask Rick Luftglass, the executive director of the Laurie Tisch Illumination Fund, to stand and accept our thanks to him and to Laurie for all they've done for Hunter College. It is now a great pleasure to welcome our panelists for tonight's discussion, who are both well-known, forceful health advocates. I say welcome because if we were to introduce Katie Couric and list all of her extraordinary accomplishments, we would be here all evening. She is, of course, well-known as an award-winning journalist who most recently joined Yahoo as Global Anchor, where she continues her extraordinary work and groundbreaking interviews. Her impact as a health activist is equally compelling. She has developed collaborative and innovative ways of tackling cancer prevention and treatment. She co-founded Stand Up to Cancer, which has raised $280 million for the cause, the National Colorectal Cancer Research Alliance, and the J. Monahan Center for Gastrointestinal Health. With Fed Up, Katie is sounding the alarm and focusing her considerable influence on America's addiction to unhealthy food. We are delighted to have her at Hunter College this evening. Dr. Tom Farley is the Joan Tisch Distinguished Public Health Fellow at Hunter College. As the former New York City Health Commissioner, he was at the forefront of using policy change to prevent the leading causes of disease and reduce health disparities. During his tenure, he advocated for groundbreaking public health policies. He was including making the city's parks and beaches smoke-free, prohibiting price discounting of cigarettes, raising the legal sales age of tobacco to 21, capping the portion size of sugary drinks sold in restaurants, and reducing sodium levels in food. At Hunter for the past 10 months, Tom has been a tremendous asset, teaching a course at the Public Health School, leading a faculty seminar, and planning numerous public programs, including just a few weeks ago, a timely panel about Ebola and the need for immediate action on it here and abroad. During Tom's stay at Roosevelt House, he is also writing a book about his experiences as health commissioner in the Bloomberg administration. We are delighted to have with us tonight Dr. Tom Farley and the extraordinary Katie Couric. Please welcome them.
Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you. First, I want to just thank President Rob for allowing us to use the space to have this wonderful event. And I also want to thank Laurie Tisch for the chance for me to be here to have great events like this. And Katie Couric, welcome to Hunter College.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here.
I have to say, it's nice to be talking about something other than Ebola.
We can talk about that if you'd like.
No, believe me. And it's worth putting some perspective on this. So the number of people in New York City who have died of Ebola so far is zero. And the number of people who have died in the last year from obesity-related problems in New York City is probably around 5,000. So this is a big problem. It deserves a lot more conversation, and maybe Ebola deserves maybe a little less conversation. It was such a powerful film. I really appreciate your doing it, and I think everyone else here does as well. I have to say, I first heard about it from my colleagues at the health department who had been working on obesity for a long time, and they saw it, and they found it very powerful, and they felt that they learned from it and were really moved by it. So they said I needed to see it, and I did. And after I saw it, then we had some conversations at Roosevelt House and said we needed to have a sort of event. So tell me, this film, I understand, was your idea. So tell me why you decided to do it and how it happened.
Well, I think as I mentioned in the film itself, I've been covering this issue for a very long time, and I've been in television news for 30 years. And it seemed to me that we were covering it so sporadically in bits and pieces. Oftentimes, what we were reporting would contradict something we had reported earlier. We had all sorts of studies and statistics. But I didn't feel as, well, first of all, I'm frustrated when a problem isn't solved, and in fact, only is getting worse. And that's what I witnessed during the course of my career. I had interviewed Stephanie Soechtig, who I think did an incredible job directing this film. She really is the driving force behind this movie. But I interviewed her about a film she did called Tapped, about the bottled water industry. It was very hard for her to get much publicity for her film because, you know, bottled water, big sponsors, bottled by big manufacturers like Pepsi, Coca-Cola, etc. And so it was hard for her, I think, to get the word out. After I interviewed her about Tapped, I said, you know, I'd be interested in doing a film about obesity for the very same reasons I just outlined. Would you ever want to do that with me? And she said, well, let me look into it, because we weren't sure there was much information that had not been told yet. And she came back and said, you know, it's sort of like a real whodunit as we unravel the causes of obesity in this country, you can see a very clear timeline. So I said, fantastic, well, let's go ahead and try to do it. So it was 3 years in the making, and you know, the first time I watched the rough cut, I thought, wow, this is so compelling, because to my mind, no one had looked at it so holistically, no one had really been able to chart the time frame of this epidemic and why all these forces came together, resulting in this terrible, terrible, you know, problem, in not only in our country but all around the world.
Yeah, well, the film points a pretty direct finger at the food industry. Did that surprise you? Were there things there that really you weren't expecting after, even though you had been covering it for all those years?
Well, you know, I remember being on the Today Show, and it was like low-fat food. We were talking all about that, and I actually remember way before that, in the early 1980s, when Snackwells came out, and I was like, holla, I can eat all the cookies I want, and it doesn't matter. And then, and you know, I don't know about you all in the audience, perhaps you're better informed than I was, but my whole life, or most of my adult life, I would automatically grab the foods that said low fat or no fat, you know, thinking that they were better for you. And I didn't realize really that until Robert Lustig talked about it in our film, that to when you extract the fat, it does taste like cardboard, so you put in all this sugar. And when I saw that our sugar consumption as a nation is some, as I believe, doubled between 1977 to 2000, I realized a lot of it was because of this added sugar to everything, to things that you don't expect to have added sugar. And I thought one of the most telling graphics, and by the way, I thought the graphics were extraordinary in this film, and this wonderful group out in Los Angeles did them, but when it's, when the ranch dressing, it said half the fat and double the sugar. I was like, I couldn't believe it. And so, you know, that was one of the really shocking things to me, that the food industry is putting so much sugar into products and yet nobody's aware of it because it's listed in grams. And only since I did this movie have I started looking at how many grams of sugar are in a serving of anything that I'm consuming. And it's shocking when I look at some of the iced tea, bottled iced tea in the store. You think, well, iced tea is better than soda, right? But then you look at the sugar content and you're like, holy bejesus, that's a lot of sugar in just one serving of one beverage, right?
Yeah. One of the things that's, it's hard to watch, I've seen the film now three times, is when the woman says, you know, well, he likes Hot Pockets, and so I get him the low-fat Hot Pockets. And she thinks she's doing the right thing, but he's clearly, he's not going to get any fewer calories, and he's going to get more sugar with the low-fat Hot Pockets.
Right, and who knows how many chemicals, right, in all those products. And I mean, it, to me, that was heartbreaking, too, you know, where you saw a mom thinking she was doing the right thing, saying cereal is a good meal supplement. Yeah. Maggie's mom said that. And, you know, I think it's so confusing for the consumer because everything says natural or healthy or organic. And there's so much misinformation, as you well know, in the labeling that, you know, what I was hoping to do with this documentary, and I think with everyone involved in, with this documentary was hoping, is that we would make consumers more educated, and that when they're making choices at the grocery store, they'll think twice about buying something that's healthy or, you know, something that's natural. And they'll see that when there's, you know, they'll be able to translate 42 grams of sugar into how many teaspoons. I didn't know the American Heart Association recommendation was 6 teaspoons of sugar a day for women, 9 for men. I mean, I think most people consume that before lunchtime in our country. So that is another thing that I think that hopefully people will walk away from. And the orange juice thing too. I mean, I thought that was a very effective visual. Yeah. To have the orange juice bottle fill up with Coca-Cola. Did you ever, I mean, obviously you know this, Dr. Farley, but what about this whole notion of fruit juices not being particularly healthy if they're consumed in large quantities?
Yeah, they certainly have plenty of calories and plenty of natural sugar, but there's still sugar in it. You know, we in New York City Health Department didn't specifically go after 100% fruit juice because when it's 100% fruit juice, it's generally sold in fairly small portions because it's expensive to make, you know, orange juice. Most of what people think of as fruit juice is not actually 100% fruit juice. It's sugar water with a little bit of fruit flavoring to it. I mean, you're going to get more calories per ounce with cranberry juice, which is mainly sugar water, than you will with Coca-Cola. So it's the whole category of fruit-flavored drinks is a real problem because people don't see them as bad as soda, but they are just as sugary.
Well, I think because they're digested so directly, it's much better to eat the actual whole fruit to have the fiber that slows the digestion. And I remember thinking when I saw this film about the fact that when I was a little girl growing up in the 60s, you know, a juice glass was about that big for orange juice in the morning, and now people consume massive quantities of orange juice. Tell us about what your experience was like when you tried to ban 16-ounce sodas in New York City. And I think it's a good illustration of some of the things that people are up against when they're trying to change people's diets or encourage a different kind of diet.
Right. Well, you know, before we did that, we tried other things than soda. First, we tried to tax soda. Then we tried to restrict it from the food stamp program. Both of those failed because of political pressures. So we said, well, one thing that the Board of Health has the authority to do is to cap the portion size. And then if people want to drink more, they can. But at least they're not served a dangerous portion of that. And the soda industry just hated it. They hated it. And they came after us with everything they've got. So they hired a PR firm, Gunther, which is the same PR firm that did the Harry and Louise ads that sunk the Clinton healthcare plan in the 1990s. And they created a front group that was called something like New Yorkers for Beverage Choices. And they held a million big gulp march rally on City Hall steps, and they ran ads on the back of trucks and on posters. And they brought in all the arguments that you saw in the movie. And then, of course, they brought the lawyers, too, and they sued the Board of Health. And ultimately, as you know, we lost the lawsuit. But I still believe very strongly that the Board of Health had that authority, and I think that was a huge loss.
Weren't you all appealing it?
We appealed to the highest level, and we lost at the highest level. It was a split decision, and some of the judges felt very strongly that the Board of Health had that authority. That's why you have a Board of Health, to prevent epidemics when political leaders are too swayed by lobbying to be able to make those decisions.
And were you surprised at the ferocity of the beverage industry? And when one of the big arguments is, you're not going to tell us what to serve our kids. Right. I remember seeing one of the commercials with the woman in the grocery store, right? And she grabs a big thing of soda and basically saying it was her God-given right to feed her children crap. And when people would put that argument to you, what would be your response generally about sort of the big brother nanny state stuff?
So, you know, the argument was that we were somehow taking away people's choices. And in fact, we weren't taking away their choices. People could drink as much as they want. Restaurants could sell as much as they want. Actually, we were increasing their choices because in many places, you can't get an 8-ounce soda. You can't even get a 16-ounce soda. The smallest might be 21. So you can always buy more, but you couldn't buy less. And so they made it sound like we were truly banning soda. That those phrase soda ban worked against us. And a lot of people bought that. I think, though, a lot of people are getting fat, and they can't prevent that. And so it would have helped them. But they really controlled so much of the conversation that I think in the long run we lost sort of the public conversation, which is a shame. In the long run, I think people will recognize it was a good idea.
Well, do you think that now, say, if you tried to do this today, because I do feel like you all were probably very much out front on this issue, and maybe it's because I've been involved with this movie, so I'm very, highly sensitized to any article that's written about this now, and I'm very keyed into it. But do you think that attitudes have changed even since the time you tried to implement this?
Yeah, I think people's attitudes and behaviors around sugary drinks are changing a lot, and there's data behind that. Soda sales in New York City are plummeting. They're falling across the rest of the country. We have falling rates of childhood obesity in New York City, and adult obesity rates are slowing down a little bit. They're not rising as fast as they were before, and I think that's connected to that. So people are starting to view those as really dangerous products. I still think we need the policies, but that attitude change is really important.
I was going to ask you about this big announcement in September by Coca-Cola, Pepsi, and I think Dr. Pepper, Snapple. And they basically pledged to cut the number of sugary drink calories that Americans consume by 1/5 in a decade. And Bill Clinton said, this is huge, this is big, it was celebrated in the media all over the place. And I was sort of scratching my head thinking, well, soda consumption has already decreased. Right. What is your opinion of that? Was it as big a deal as President Clinton claimed it was? Because I know it was announced at CGI.
Yeah, so you know, 20% decline sounds like a pretty big decline, but it was 20% over 10 years. So that's 2% decline per year. Soda consumption in the United States right now is falling at about 1 or 2% per year. In the last year, it fell 3%. So basically what they're doing is they're taking credit for what's happening anyway, despite the fact that they're advertising as much as they can. You know, if the soda companies wanted to reduce soda consumption, they could do it in a year just by not doing the advertising and marketing that they're doing now.
How big a role do you think marketing plays in all this? I mean, I was shocked at the number of commercials that children are accosted by, and we were talking backstage before we walked on stage about the fact that I believe Norway has banned advertising to children, because I do think kids are programmed from a very, very early age to be aware of these kinds of foods and to crave them.
Yeah, I mean, I think marketing is huge. Coke and Pepsi see themselves first and foremost as marketing companies. They don't see themselves really as beverage companies or food companies. Marketing is what they do, is the core of their business. And it's not just marketing to kids, although that's certainly the worst, but marketing to all of us. We think we're more intelligent than that and shouldn't have an impact, but it clearly does, or they wouldn't spend so many billions doing it.
You don't think Ronald McDonald inspires kids through magic and fun?
That was quite a quote, I gotta say.
I felt so bad for that lady having to say that on Capitol Hill.
Yeah, it is. You do wonder what they think about when they get up in the morning preparing those lines.
Well, I thought Tom Harkin was a really compelling person in this documentary because he said just that. Do you think that comparisons with the... We're supposed to interview each other, by the way. Do you think... So obviously, I like asking questions. Do you think comparisons with the tobacco industry are fair?
You know, they're fair in this sense, that the tobacco companies are corporations, the food companies are corporations. They're answerable to their stockholders and shareholders. And so they have to make a bigger profit each year. And so if they're doing something which is bad for people's health, but it is profitable, they're going to keep doing it. It doesn't matter what even the personal opinions are of the executives in those companies. That's what they're paid to do. And so there are certain things that the only way they'll stop doing them, no matter how bad they are, is if the government says, you cannot do this. And so that's what we learned with tobacco. We put in place a number of regulations, and smoking rates are falling in this country. We're going to have to do that with sugary drinks and with food as well.
So you think the government's going to have to get involved and regulation is going to have to take hold?
Well, I mean, first of all, you know, the government is already involved in the food business from farm to the time it gets into your mouth. We subsidize corn, we subsidize sugar, we regulate restaurants, we buy food for people through the SNAP program. So it's not the question of should the government be in the business. The question is, should the government update its regulations to match a new health problem of this era? And clearly they should, but that means that there's a lot of leverage to do that.
So can you give us some concrete examples of things the government could and should do in terms of food consumption?
Right. Well, first of all, it can change our food subsidy program. So rather than subsidizing corn, so we make corn syrup, if we're subsidizing broccoli, we're going to be probably eating a lot more broccoli. Then you got the food stamp program. Right now, any grocery store that wants to essentially can participate in that program, but they could put a more stringent requirement. So in order for them to participate, they might have to have a greater display of produce and a smaller display of junky food. And then we can get food advertising off of kids' TV. I mean, that's something we should have done decades ago. So there's lots of things that are obvious to do. It's not that we haven't figured it out. It's just because the lobbying of the food companies have prevented us from doing it.
I was struck by Bill Clinton's statement that if we just got rid of the junky food in school cafeterias, that would really help us make a lot of progress in terms of childhood obesity. So can you talk about, first of all, I guess there's an economic incentive for many of these school districts because they get paid when they carry certain food products, right?
And they get paid on how many meals the kids take from them.
But also, I mean, if you have Coca-Cola in a school, right?
Oh, yes, they get
an
extra payment from Coke.
Don't they get...
Yes, they get a cut of that.
So, you know, it's how do you disincentivize schools? Because a particular time where they need the money, you know, their budgets might have been cut, to not carry these unhealthy items.
Yeah, you know, so the schools get that money. And actually, in fact, it's not a huge amount of money. But it's money that's discretionary. It's money the principal, the superintendent can spend for whatever he wants. And most of the money they have has got a lot of strings attached to it. So that's like gold for an administrator. But it is a pact with the devil. And I think parents and all of us need to say to schools it's really not worth it. That small amount of money is something that should be replaced in some other way so that our kids aren't getting sick.
Can I just ask you one more question?
All right.
No, I've been surprised because I've often heard about cafeterias, about schools trying to serve healthier food to their kids. And it's shocking to me that sometimes it's the parents who object. Yeah. And then you hear stories about all the waste, all the healthy food that's being thrown away. So how do you attack those two problems?
Well, first of all, yeah, there are some parents who do complain about that, but it's not good for their kids. And kids are used to eating junk food all the time, and so if you suddenly give them something that's healthy, they're going to have a tendency to turn away from it. But to me, we ought to have a principle that if you are required as a parent to send your child to school, and that school ought to have only healthy food in it. There's no justification for then giving that kid something he's sick. It's going to make him sick. So if that were the case from the beginning, then kids would get used to the idea that this is where healthy food is, and over time they get accustomed to it. And they got to get the junk food out so there's no competition with the junky food. So, but I want to ask you about those kids, though. I was really affected by the kids. What can you tell us about what's happening to those kids now?
Well, you know, obviously, you know, it didn't have the storybook ending I was hoping it would have, because in the process of making the film, Brady had lost a good bit of weight, and it was sort of like, oh, that's so great, you know. Mark Hyman went in there, he taught them how to eat real food and healthy food, but unfortunately, as we saw, it was like, I mean, it was so heartbreaking. Brady gained all his weight back. He has started college. We are really happy that we helped support his college education. He's the same weight. I think, you know, we were talking earlier, Tom and I, about sort of the socioeconomic factors behind obesity. Brady was working in a fast food restaurant. Obviously, you know, I don't think they had a lot. That wasn't a family with a great deal of means. And I think he was in the food environment he was in made it extremely difficult for him to completely change his brain chemistry and to eat healthy food. I think he sold candy bars for his school, you know, to fund a school project, working in a fast food restaurant. And it breaks my heart. I wish somebody could work with him, because he was such an eloquent, well-spoken, incredibly candid young man. And the fact that he was willing to talk so openly about this, I think, you know, we really owe him a debt of gratitude. His mom, Tina, meanwhile, has lost 100 pounds and has been able to keep it off, which is great news for her. Wesley from Texas, I think his weight is the same. Maggie is working with someone who was featured briefly in the film, someone here in New York City named High Voltage, who's great. Her real name is Kathy Dulgen. But she goes and she talks to inner city kids about the importance of changing your diet. She's worked with Mother Cabrini schools. She's worked with Ann Tisch's women, girls leadership schools. And I know that Maggie from Oklahoma is working with her, and she's actually having some success. I think.
What about Joe Lopez, the guy that
he's lost 100 pounds, but he had bariatric surgery.
Has he had complications from the surgery?
No, I think he's actually doing well. But I thought one of the bites in the documentary is, what does it say to us? What does it say about us as a nation? I can't remember exactly, but the fact that we will allow these kids to have this major invasive surgery that can have a whole host of side effects and not actually, you know, help them just be a healthy weight to begin with. I mean, I don't know how you feel about bariatric surgery, but it certainly should be something that's a last resort, as far as I know.
It should be rare. And you hear sometimes people presenting that as a solution to the obesity epidemic. And it's, believe me, it's not a solution. And some of these policy changes could greatly reduce the number of people, let alone kids, who need that sort of surgery.
And I read, I think, in the New York Times how so many of these kids are being diagnosed with fatty liver disease. And obviously, the number of type 2 diabetics has just skyrocketed. I thought another shocking statistic in the documentary is 1980, zero cases of type 2 diabetes, adult onset diabetes among adolescents. And in 2010, something like 57,000. And the fact that this is the first generation of children who are expected to lead shorter lifespans than their parents. If I was a kid, I would be staging an all-out riot about that. Right. You know, I used to flush my mom's cigarettes down the toilet, my brother and I did, and I feel like kids have got to take back their health, just like we protested against cigarettes.
Yeah, yeah. You know, one of the things that I really love about the film is how much it frames the problem around what the food industry has done and what government has done, and there's a lot of blame to go around about that. But if you watch TV most of the time, it's framed as it's presented at the beginning of the movie, that this is a matter of personal responsibility. So do you have any suggestion on what we can do to get the media to change the narrative along the lines of what your movie is doing, to get people to really understand these larger forces? Because that's what we need to focus on to get the solutions.
I think it's pretty tough. You know, as long as shows like The Biggest Losers exist, and as long as, you know, you have talk show hosts peddling certain miracle weight loss products, it's pretty hard to change the conversation. It's also difficult because, you know, these, I think just a handful of food companies basically manufacture every food product in America, isn't
yes,
that right?
It's a very small number of products.
It's shocking, and guess who sponsors a lot of television? Those
so
big.
What were your big sponsors at the Today Show?
Oh, I mean, you name it. Everything. All sorts of food products. In fact, it was interesting because I tried to get this documentary shown at the Aspen Ideas Festival. But there was a real problem because Pepsi is the sponsor of the Aspen Ideas Festival. Oh. And they weren't really keen on showing this movie when Pepsi was giving them so much money to support this festival. So I think there's a
real... Did they show it, or was it...
No.
No, in the end they didn't.
No. Absolutely not. I mean, it was a conversation stopper, pretty much. And so I think the best we can do is really educate consumers. I think we need to do things like explain that 4 grams of sugar equals 1 teaspoon, that sugar is hidden in everything. But I think we have a very kind of schizophrenic attitude towards food, right? You know, people are on a treadmill watching them make, you know, Paula Deen make 2 glazed donuts with a hamburger in between on the Food Network, you know? So I think we get a lot of mixed messages, I think, when it comes to our attitude towards food in our culture.
Well, I mean, the fact of the matter is, we might as well admit it, that junk food tastes good, right? It's designed to taste good. There are special companies that design the flavors behind food so that it's...
Oh, right, you know, they manipulate it.
Yeah.
In fact, I met Ron Howard. That's a little bit of a name drop, isn't it? But I did, and he told me, I showed him the trailer for this movie, that he had... sat on a plane next to someone who was sort of the flavor magician for Frappuccinos. And she told him, you know, I didn't mind coming up with all these flavors until I walked around my neighborhood and I saw 10-year-old kids drinking these giant Frappuccinos after school. And she said she couldn't in good conscience continue to do that, so she quit. But you're right, everything is manipulated, and David Kessler is a genius about this, right? To have this the correct amount of sort of fat and sugar that makes us, I mean, it does. I think it probably lights up our pleasure centers in the brain like there's no tomorrow. The dopamine's like, yay, this is so great. And in fact, a friend of mine told me her daughter, she was, I think, 2 or 3, she goes, she had her first taste, she wasn't excited about this, but she just mentioned that Emma had a taste of an Oreo, and she was running around like she was on crack. And I was like, there's a reason for that. You know, don't, you know, and I think from a very early age, our taste buds get programmed and our brains get co-opted by this certain kind of food.
Well, I think a lot of the fast food presence in schools is actually less about the money they make for selling that to those kids at that time as it is the branding. It's teaching kids that
well, did you see those Coca-Cola chairs that, you know, are used in preschools? I mean, how outrageous is that?
Right. Well, like the school store where they have McDonald's on Fridays and, you know, Papa John's on Wednesdays, that's each of those companies putting their brand in the kids' brain so that during the rest of their entire life, they're going to go there for food.
I think it's really disgusting.
Right.
Personally, honestly.
So let me, you know, Michelle Obama, you were pretty tough on Michelle Obama there, and I think appropriately so, but what sort of reaction have you gotten from the film about the handling of Michelle Obama? And,
well,
and let's move.
You know, I think, I hope we give her due and at least putting it on the radar screen, getting people to talk about it. The first cut was a little tougher on Michelle Obama, and I was like, whoa, I still have to interview the president at some point. I think that while she's made the issue an important part of the national dialogue, there is something a little, I mean, I guess it depends. I think there are two different attitudes, and I'll throw this question back at you.
Okay.
Artfully done, right? which is, can you work Can you work with the status quo? Can you work with established food companies? Can you collaborate with big food to come up with solutions? Yeah. Or is that impossible?
Yeah. You know, that is a really good question, and something that we wrestled with a lot when I was at the health department. And in the end, we ended up working with sometimes the same big food companies in a cooperative way at the same time that they were suing us on something else. So I think that there are areas where the food companies can make a voluntary change which doesn't hurt their profits at all or much, that's good for health, and if they can, we should encourage them to do that and work with them to do it. But there are other times when we simply have to say, no, you cannot do that. So the relationship between health people and food companies in the future, to me, is going to be this weird combination of cooperation and conflict, and I don't see there's any other way to get around it.
And I think there probably are decent things that food companies can do that are more than just tinkering slightly and reducing something by 10 calories, right? I imagine there are ways to make, to have more honest labeling and, right. and to not have foods purported to have certain qualities that they don't, and to change the ingredients so they truly are healthier. Right. I think there's a real fear that if they change the ingredients too much and tinker with it too much, that people will stop craving that very item that they need to sell in order to make a profit, right?
Right. Well, one of the things we did with the food companies here was that we asked them to lower the amount of salt that they put in food, which has nothing to do with obesity, but has a lot to do with health. And a number of companies did reduce their sodium levels in food, enough to where we think that there can be real health benefit from that. Not going to solve the obesity problem, and there's a lot of things it won't do, but if they can do that, and we can do it collaboratively, we should.
But I think, you know, there's a difference of opinion. Michael Pollan does not believe that you can really work with right. these food companies. And I think that's, he was especially critical of Michelle Obama for joining forces with these companies. But I think, as you point out, Tom, there are certain cases where it can be effective.
Yeah, yeah. So,
do you want to open it up to the audience?
Yeah, this sounds like a good time.
Are you
to do
over
that.
Me?
Yeah. I'm sure they're not over you. So, with the lights, I'm having a little trouble seeing you, but I see a microphone over there with Cindy. So there's a woman there. Yes, can you hand her the mic?
I thought that movie was fabulous, just wonderful, Katie.
Thank you.
What I'm disturbed about is it's you know, it's fine to be an informed consumer, which I think I really am. And it's not helping me a bit because, for instance, there's a chain of supermarkets in Manhattan. I have been begging them and begging them to bring, they have this wonderful healthy rye cracker, which they get rid, it's fabulous, no sugar, really healthy. They get rid of it after Christmas because it's, quote, seasonal. So I went up to them and I said, what is, I don't know, you can't eat rye in February and March? Is it like a poinsettia just for Christmas? Because they have it in December. I said, you substituted it without, you know, I found out they substituted another cracker. Oh, it's got rye in it along with 29 grams of sugar and everything else. So they got rid of the healthy one to get some junk.
Can you go to a different grocery store?
Very hard to find. I mean, there's just a limit to how much I can cook from scratch.
Right.
I mean, I went through everything. I can't find a cereal in there without 5, 6, 7 grams of sugar for half a cup. It's wonderful to be a farm consumer, but they said to me, well, you're very negative. You have to accept that. I said, negative? I just want a healthy cracker? That's negative?
Well, could, I mean,
I swear, this is, he said, well, that's what sells, and we have 697 stores, and most people like the other cracker. I said, but it's filled with sugar. It was just an endless, ridiculous debate. Ends up, they're not going to get it back. It's discontinued because it's not popular.
Okay.
Thank you.
So much for being an informed consumer. It doesn't help me.
So what do you advise people
well,
who
you know,
really, you know, I do think that, I think it is hard to sometimes make healthy choices in terms of what's available. So what's your advice on that?
One of the things that I think that we haven't been clear enough about, but your film is good about, is that we all should be eating more just unprocessed food. You know, the stuff that you get in the produce aisle rather than the stuff you get in the regular aisles with all the racks. And so that includes crackers. You know, crackers aren't the worst thing in the world, But they're not really terribly healthy either. And if we all spend our time eating more fruits and vegetables, we'd all be an awful lot healthier. Let me take another question. I see a gentleman, I think, in the back with a red vest on, a hat. I'm sorry, I can't see well.
Oh, it's a woman. Hi.
No, sorry.
We can't. No, you know what?
You know, it's a hat, honey.
We just can't. We can't see anything up here. Sorry.
You're permitted to insult me when we're done.
I'm sorry. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Hi. I'm actually a student at the New School, and I'm actually working with a CSA called Corbin Hill, and we go into like East New York, and as I'm sitting there passing out the produce to my shareholders every week, I find people walking by, particularly children and people who look hungry. If they had it in their face, they will choose vegetables every single time. The second thing, that was just a comment. The second thing is, if we're talking about marketing, as a diabetic, I was originally diagnosed as type 2, changed my diet, never was into sugar, never into anything else, was always thin, but I was misdiagnosed and I really am type 1. So my whole concept of food is completely different. The thing I don't like is when I see advertisement or any political commentary about if you drink sugar, you'll become diabetic. Is there any way that we can reverse that and say, people who are diabetics or who are under strict dietary, these are people you need to follow. These are the healthier ways to think about food as opposed to the scare tactic of, if you don't do this, as a verse of, this is how we can attack the food industry. Can we, any way of like marketing differently, think about it differently, as opposed to scare tactics?
You know, I'm going to say this. When we were trying to reduce smoking rates in New York City, we once ran an ad that was a very positive ad, encouraging people to quit. It was called Everybody Loves a Quitter. Very upbeat, warm and fuzzy. Nobody paid any attention to it whatsoever. And then we put some very tough negative ads out there that says smoking kills. Smoking's going to give you throat cancer. And people perked up and they called our quit line and tried to quit. So we learned actually, you know what? Scare tactics do work. And I don't like to scare people any more than anyone else does. But if we're saving lives doing that, I think maybe that's what we need to do. So I think we need to be more direct that this junk food kills you. On that note, let's see. I see a couple of hands in the back there. There we are. Yes.
Hi. My name is Tatanisha. I'm a public health doctorate student at CUNY Graduate Center. And when I was in school, I took home ec. And I have been monitoring that what happened to nutrition education in school, because we're talking about, you know, kids taking a stand and taking the lead on that. Where are they getting their information? And that would be a good place for them to start mobilizing and to really start to understand. So where is nutrition education? I mean, they took out gym, they took out music, they took out, you know, home ec and these types of things that would inform kids in the environment that they're in 6 to 8 hours a day.
I think that's such a good question because I've wondered that myself, you know.
Did you get to have home ec when you're doing
this? I had home ec, yeah, I made a dirndl skirt. I think I got a C, but whatever. but I do think that there has to be more nutrition. I mean, is it under the rubric of health class now?
Yeah, it's under health education, and it's there. But I'll have to say, if you teach kids in a health class that you should only eat fruits and vegetables, and then they walk outside and there's a vending machine selling junk food, all they really learn is that we're hypocrites. So the first thing we need to do is get the junk food out of schools. And then the education, yeah, it's there, and we should continue that.
And I think it has to happen at a really early age, you know, to my point about my friend giving her daughter an Oreo. I mean, I think that parents need to understand that they have to really start introducing these foods to kids when they're toddlers. You know, I help mentor some kids in up in Harlem, and I'd love to talk to you about food deserts in a second. I don't know if you all are interested in that, because I'm wondering about the socioeconomic ramifications of all this. But I noticed that the kids were getting heavier and heavier. So one Mother's Day, my daughter and I took them to the farmer's market down at Union Square. And many of these kids, one of the little girls that we work with, she was 10 years old and she had never eaten a raw carrot before. And many of the kids really had not seen an asparagus, mushrooms. We bought some of the food. We went back to my apartment. We made lunch. I cooked up some of the vegetables and we sort of had a lunch, and we tried a lot of these things. But it's shocking to me how, because of people's lives, because convenience food is so ubiquitous, right, that some of these kids in our country have never been exposed to real food. So how can we change that? And you know, that's really upsetting to me, especially in some of these urban centers that don't have access to the produce that maybe other communities do.
Yeah, well, I'm going to say this, that there's the problem of limited access to healthy food, and that's real, but the much bigger problem is this overabundance of the junky food. So I think less about food deserts and more about junk food swamps, that our kids are just surrounded, they're drowning in junk food, that's all they see. And you notice the difference, you know, we're on the Upper East Side. If you walk from here and cross 96th Street, all of a sudden you see all the bodegas, and they're selling chips and soda, all the worst stuff to sell, along with beer and cigarettes. And if you grow up and that's all you see, then that's what you think everybody should have for the rest of your life. And so we need to somehow reduce the availability of the junky food.
Because it has such a ripple effect. You know, when kids eat healthier, they perform better academically. And, you know, I think that a lot of these kids are really operating from a deficit that's really unfair and not of their own doing.
It's our fault as adults. We created the world. Let's see. I see a hand right in the center. And I think you have a red hat on.
Yeah,
yes.
I'm pretty loud, actually. So, thank you for your film. You mentioned quite a bit about socioeconomics. But in the film, you mentioned how it was $26 for if you bought like fast food, but like only like $13 if you bought it healthy. And you made
right.
But one thing that you didn't that wasn't addressed was the time,
right?
Which is I think really important to talk about. So can you talk a little bit about what you think? How do you solve that problem of parents having the time to actually cook the foods who are in these poor socioeconomic status?
I mean, I think in some cases you're right. I mean, I think you have got a single mom who's working two jobs or who doesn't have, you know, may not have time. I think we as a society need to help people figure out there are some things you can cook pretty quickly. And I also think it's a matter of priorities. You know, I think sort of like I don't have time is a little bit of a bullshit answer in some cases. You know, I think that some parents need to say, you know what, we're gonna make time, or on Sunday I'm gonna make these things and put them in the freezer, or I'm gonna get a chicken breast, and how long does it take to cook a chicken breast? It takes like, you know, when you're putting in a pan with chicken stock or whatever, it doesn't take much time. So I think you're right, in a lot of cases it is very difficult. But I also think we have to reorder our priorities and do a better job in educating people. You know, frozen vegetables, right? That's what my mom fixed when I was growing up, you know, and even canned vegetables, although they have the PBA issue, right?
Well, I'm more worried about the salt.
Yeah, okay, salt. But frozen, flash frozen vegetables can sometimes be prepared pretty quickly.
Right.
I just think that I think it's a real consideration and an issue, but we can't just sort of buy into it all the time. We have to work around it. Otherwise, you know, we'll just say, you don't have time, feed your kids a couple of Big Macs and call it a day, right? I mean, what's the alternative? It's complicated, I know. It is, but I also think, you know, one of the disappointments for me about the film, you know, is that we didn't focus more on solutions, that we didn't say, okay, here are real clear-cut things you could do. But by the time we really trace the epidemic, we didn't really have time. That's why we have the website. That's why I'd like to continue helping people and figuring out ways that we can get this really important information to schools, to PTA meetings, help parents with some clear-cut solutions.
Let me just say about the socioeconomic status issue. It is true that obesity rates are higher in lower-income people, but obesity rates are higher across the board. You know, upper-income people are overweight too much also, so it's not just a poverty issue. Really,
you know, the only place it's not true is probably the Upper East Side at certain restaurants where they don't eat
all
anything.
Right.
But it's true, you know, we tried to show a real cross-section of kids. I don't know if you notice that, but we tried to make them racially and geographically diverse to kind of represent that this problem isn't only among low-income kids.
So we have time for two more quick questions. I see a gentleman there with his hand up. That's right. Yes.
Hi, my name is Jacob Daniels. I'm a student at Hunter College. How can an average consumer choose a healthy product if even our so-called organic food is 80% genetically modified organisms? So even our crops and vegetables, 80% of what's being produced in this country are filled with GMOs, which is also deteriorating our health and causing an increase in breast cancer. So even the foods that we think are healthy are really not, and are also run by the same corporations that are trying to stay in business and not caring about our health.
I told Tom that GMOs might come up tonight. I don't feel adequately versed on GMOs to really talk about them. I know that studies, well, I'd like to hear your opinion, you're a doctor. Studies have shown that GMOs are not harmful, but in Europe they've been banned. Certainly, it's sort of a little Dr. Strangelove and nerve-wracking for right. consumers. So where do you come down on genetically modified organisms?
Yeah, I view it that way. The immediate health issues are not a problem. Vegetables like that are, I'm sure, just as healthy. The concern is really over the long term. If you're tinkering with the DNA of an organism, what happens to it beyond that, we don't know. I'm not sure that 80% of what you get in the grocery store has GMO in it. But that's really not going to deal with the obesity issue. The obesity issue has to do really with processed food, with the food that comes in a box or a bottle or a can. If people stuck to the produce aisle, we would have a lot lower obesity rates in this country. Okay, one more question here. Let me take this, a woman right down here.
I love that people are all fired up here.
I'm
so
sorry
that's
we can't
good.
Take all your questions. This is going to have to be the last one.
Hi, thank you for taking my question. I have a question about a different group of the population that we haven't addressed yet, which they mentioned in the movie, the American military, and how if we don't have people that are fit, there's not people to defend our country. I do a lot of work with veterans initiatives, and the food that is in their chow halls, as they call them, is white bread, is all the junk that we watched for the last 90 minutes. Do you have any ideas on what, because a lot of this is targeting food companies and the American population, how we can go about changing something like that? That's a part of the government.
I'll let you change the Pentagon first. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'll be making a call to the Pentagon tomorrow. You know, I really do, you know, it's interesting because I actually know that because I did cover the Pentagon and I went and talked to a lot of troops during my time at the Pentagon and some of the chow that they were eating, you're right, is really unhealthy. I think what this refers to, though, are the kids that are growing up that are not going to be fit to serve, to even get into the military. But in terms of the food that our troops are being served or are eating, I mean, are there any efforts?
Have you ever eaten an MRE?
Oh, yes, I have.
Oh, yeah. I think they have about 7,000 calories in them. They're unbelievable. And I think that
well, I mean, in fairness, that's for somebody who's deployed, who's not going to be able to have access to much food, who needs the nutrients and the calories, right?
Right, yes. Well, the assumption is that they're, you know, walking 30 miles with a 70-pound backpack that day. But a lot of times the military these days are actually behind a machine. And so they're going to need to adjust their food according to what the soldiers are actually doing.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's not end on that. Let's ask one more. Why don't we do
all
it?
Right.
Come on. I'm having fun. Are you guys Jesus. Okay? I do have to go home at some point.
over here, I don't know where the mic is, but there's a woman right there. Hold on one sec till we can see if we can get a mic to you. Oh, I think she left. All right,
oh, she left.
Go ahead and just
shout
it out, and then we'll be done.
Well, thank you. You know, it is, you can download it on iTunes, Amazon, I believe Netflix, and the DVD is available. We're trying to do a shortened version for schools all across the country because I would love students, middle school students, to see this. But I think we really need a national concerted effort. And I think, you know, in fairness to the First Lady, I mean, I do think at least we're talking about it.
Right.
And I think she has taken some positive steps, towards making cafeteria food healthier and with labels and things like that. Would you agree?
Yeah, I would agree that she's done a really good job of raising the issue as a serious topic rather than just sort of some little thing an individual person needs to worry about. And the school food law as written is not too bad. Now it's not being implemented yet, so there's many more battles to be fought, but there's definitely progress, and we got to give her credit for that.
And I think, you know, what you, people like you all can do, concerned citizens, you can tell your friends about the film. And, you know, everyone I know who sees it, who I'm friendly with, you know, who talks to me, says, you know, I really look at the food I'm buying and the food I'm eating differently now. And, you know, that's really where a conscious raising movement starts, with just individuals at the grassroots level. So the more we can get the word out, the more we can explain to people the importance of this issue and the ramifications of doing nothing, I think the better off we'll be. That's a good way to end
it. That is a great way to end.
Thank you.
Katie Clark. So,
okay.
Let me just say, thank you very much for being here tonight. Thank you for even more for producing the film in the first place. Thank you for coming.
Thank you all so much for coming.